Dr. Chandra. So it's a great pleasure to be here, and I've always admired the EMBL so much. I also have a co-affiliation via the MMPU with the MBL, and I mean, it's a wonderful institution, particularly for the molecular aspects of life. So it was a challenge to, Fajardo wanted me to also talk about, you know, the artistic side, the social side, the emotional side of pain, and I hope that I can kind of strike a balance. So chronic pain, of course, is a huge huge and important problem in society. It's one of the major causes of you know, economic burden that we carry. Apparently, the cost that you have from people who cannot work because of chronic pain is even higher than the costs that are incurred with cancer and cardiovascular diseases put together. And according to the recent demographic studies, every fifth European suffers from chronic pain. But you know, that's not the reason why I'm fascinated about pain. I mean, that makes it easier to get grants and things like that. But the main reason why I find chronic pain so fascinating is because it's a double-edged sword. So it has two sides, and it kind of reminds me very much of a book that I had read as a child. I'm sure you've read it too. That's The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde by R.L. Stevenson. And you remember, this kind doctor, this extremely benign doctor, Jekyll, who would then, you know, have his dark side come out sometimes, and that would be this horrendous murderer, Mr. Hyde. And this is exactly how it is with pain. It is a protector and a tormentor at the same time. And why is it a protector? Well, if you do not have pain, this is how your life would look like. So we don't want to now elaborate too much on that. People who do not have pain actually suffer very, very much. They may not suffer from pain, but they suffer much more because they are constantly hurting themselves. They have a very short life. It's very rare to have even people, you know, go well into adulthood. Many of them die earlier because they do not, you know, sense environmental as well as other painful stimuli. So acute pain is indeed a protector. You do not ever want to get rid of your ability to feel pain. And Charles Darwin even said that pain is very important for the survival of species. This is has been a major driver of evolution. But of course, pain has another side, a horrible side, and that is then given by all these chronic pain disorders that we all know about. It seems that pain is the most common symptom of disorders. It's one of the most common reasons why one goes to the doctor, and that's how it leads to the diagnosis of a wide variety of disorders, such as metabolic disorders, you know, for example, diabetes, very common, cancer, variety of neuropathies, and other forms of injury. Chronic back pain is very, very common. I mean, amongst the elderly, you know, every second person has back pain. This may come both from injury as well as from inflammation. And of course, you've heard of variety of inflammatory disorders such as arthritis. So a person who feels, you know, who suffers from chronic pain really is not just suffering because of the pain itself, but there is a huge amount of despair, depression, you know, loss of focus, huge amount of stress that comes with this life. So the big question that we have is, how is this physiological stimulus or physiological function which serves to protect us, how does this get converted into this horrible disease? And can we then also treat this disease without losing this important function of physiological pain that we don't want to lose? Because otherwise you could say it's easy. You just simply, you know, use an anesthetic and simply get rid of that part of the nervous system that is causing pain, right? But then that would also lead to loss of physiological pain, which you don't want to do. And that's actually the challenge. So we'll start now with a textbook view. And I promise, Haldo, that I will go into then, you know, way beyond what we know right now and go actually back in the history to see what we know about pain. So this is what a textbook tells us. It says, we feel, you know, for example, in the morning, if you turn up the water and you're sensing, you know, during your shower, whether the water is hot or cold, is it the right temperature? And this is based upon a feedback system. So your the sensory nerve endings in your skin basically carry over the spinal cord. What is not shown is the synapse in the spinal cord. Then the pain stimulus or the nociceptive stimulus to the brain, for example, the somatosensory cortex. And there, the somatosensory cortex quickly processes, tells the motor cortex sends the impulses back to your limb. And if the water is too hot, you quickly withdraw your hand away, right, before you cause any serious injury to yourself. So this would indicate that this is a very clear-cut, you know, sensory function. But that's not all what pain is about. I mean, when people suffer from chronic pain, or especially, you know, chronic pain, not just chronic pain, also acute pain, they are not complaining about just this sensory aspect, which makes them actually protect themselves. What they're complaining about is this feeling of hurt, this deep attack on your psyche, which is pain. And therefore, many scholars, you know, very eminent scholars throughout history, starting from the ancient Greeks, have argued whether pain is a sensory experience or is it rather an emotion. And what we'll do now is kind of take you know, trip down the history lane. We'll start off with the ancient Greeks, with Aristotle and Plato. Then we can go to the Renaissance, to René Descartes, and then we can go, of course, we can't miss Darwin, right? We'll go via the evolution theory of pain as well. So let's start with, you know, the very, very antique times. This is when pain was considered as an act of God. And I know we live now in the 21st century, but if you were to ask my mother, she would still think, you know, she would not want to go to a doctor if she's suffering from chronic pain. And why is that? Because, and this applies, I think, to many of our relatives in India and many other cultures too, the elderly ones, they say, you know, I've had such a good life, but I also have to suffer a little bit, right? So this is what God has given me. It's seen as, you know, something that is fate. It's an act of God. And indeed, in the mystiques, that adds a lot of mystique, of course, to this, to the phenomenon of pain. And even highly learned people, such as Aristotle and Plato, actually saw pain as an external force. They did not consider pain to be a part of, you know, the basic biology of our body, but they thought it's an external force that invades and pervades the body. And this is given even by the name pain. Pain actually comes from the Latin term piona, which means penalty. So this is punishment, right? This is a test of faith. And that's why for many people, it's very hard to go to the doctor and say, I have pain, because this is a test of how strong they are, of how much faith they have. Now, interestingly, in those times, it was thought that the pain is a kind of a spirit that enters the body at the place where you have injury. So if you have an injury, that's where the spirit would enter into your body and then reside in your heart. And your heart is what would feel the pain. Now, this reflected the belief at that time that, you know, we thought via our heart. There was no, you know, concept that the brain actually would play an important role. And this came so many hundred years later, as you see here, right? Nearly 1,000 years, or even more than 1,000 years later. This is when René Descartes, a major thinker in the Renaissance period, for the first time introduced many groundbreaking principles, many of which have been shown to be true with modern biology. So one thing he said was that pain is not an external force, but rather it's an internal process. And he saw the body as a machine. So this was for the first time where he kind of demystified the body, where he said, you know, the body is like a machine. And if the machine does not work, it has to have a symptom that tells you something's not working. And that's what pain is all about. So, however, for him also, pain was a sensory experience. He did not attach, you know, any significance to the emotional aspect of pain. But he gave us our very first drawing of the pain pathway. This is a highly appreciated, highly reproduced drawing from René Descartes. What he shows here is that we have this pathway that goes from the periphery, now you notice, for the first time, to the brain. So he was the person who for the first time postulated that we feel not with our hearts, but actually with our brain. And I'd just like to show you a couple of, you know, sentences that he said, because, I mean, this is a guy who had no concept of molecular biology, of course, or of, you know, microscopy. But many of the things he said, what he tried to put in words, are so true for today. So he said in the 17th century, that, for example, if a fire, which he called, you know, A, comes in contact with this part of the body, which he called B, then you have minute particles of this fire, which, as you know, move with great velocity, have the power to set in motion the spot of the skin of the foot, which they touch. And by this means, pulling upon a delicate thread. So he drew a thread that goes all the way to the brain. And this thread is nothing other than a nerve. At that time, this principle did not exist, right? And what he said was even better. He said, it pulls at that, it is attached to this part of the skin, and it opens at the same instant the pore. He designated that there would be a pore. And now coming to think of it, that's what ion channels are, right? They are the ones that are first activated. Those are the pores that get activated. And he thought once that pore is activated, something flows here. It's not quite wrong, right? That's how nerve impulses travel. Just not in the, he thought it would be an aqueduct. It's not really an aqueduct, but it's an electrical relay, so to speak. And he said, just by pulling at one end of the rope, one makes to strike at the instant a bell which hangs on the other side. And importantly, the bell for him was pain, and that was in the brain. Now, that was actually the beginning of the so-called specificity theory of pain. Started with Descartes, it went on with Müller in 1940, von Frey in the mid-1900s. These are the, you know, set of scientists who thought that pain is a very specific sensation. So just like we have, you know, vision, we have olfaction, we have auditory senses, right, hearing, we have pain. And this is a very definitive hardwired pathway, which has nothing in common with our touch pathway. In contrast, there were others who were the proponents of the intensity theory who said, no, touch and pain are one and the same thing, depends on how, or they are mediated by the same pathway, depends on how intensely you activate. If it's low intensity, it's touch, but if you were to just push, then it would become pain. Pattern theory said, no, these are different patterns. If you have one pattern of activation, it's touch, another pattern of activation, it would be pain. And then finally, there was a gate control theory, which postulated, this is the most widely accepted theory so far, which said that there is a gate in the spinal cord. And this gate can differentiate between touch, it can tell us when we're feeling touch and when we're feeling pain. And only when the gate opens, you can feel pain. And this is true. This gate is given by inhibition in the spinal cord. But none of the theories, of course, are completely right. There are elements of the specificity theory and the gate control theory, which have been proved to be right so far. But now let's go back again to evolution. What did the naturalists think about pain? Now, as I said already, it was already recognized that pain is important for the survival of species. But they also considered pain in a purely sensory sense. They thought it's, you know, a way in which you can defend yourself. And they postulated that intensity of pain is proportional to the danger. The bigger the danger that stimulus, you know, presents for you, the more intense your pain will be. And this is, I mean, all of us who have little children have seen that, right? We have seen how our children, you know, only learn once what fire is all about. And after that, they stay away from that, right? So that seems to be true. But on the other hand, all of us at some point or another have had our hand cut by a simple, you know, sheet of paper, right? Now, paper is not a really a very threatening stimulus, and yet it can cause us intense pain. So there are, of course, problems with this theory. And according to this theory, you don't really need a brain for pain, because, and you know, maybe you can find some resonance for this also in the fact that even lower organisms, if you were to have your C. elegans, I'm sure some of you are working with worms, and you prod it with a glass rod, the worm will retract. Question is it just a reflex, or is it really feeling something? Is it really, you know, pain as such? And secondly, they drew also from the fact that if you were to decerebrate frogs, these were experiments that were done, they seem to sense pain. You can still stimulate the skin for a certain period of time, and the paw and the frog will withdraw itself. And then there is this huge debate about whether humans in coma feel pain or not. In fact, pain is used as a diagnostic criteria to see how deep you are in your coma. And in fact, several stages of coma are given by a ability to feel pain. I mean, they do not lack the ability to feel pain. So again, asking, you know, where does pain really come from? Do you really need your brain to be active during pain? Charles Darwin, on the other hand, although he was a naturalist and, you know, of course, the pioneer of the naturalist, he had a broader view of pain. For him, pain was also an emotion. And in fact, he called pain a homeostatic emotion. Now, you know, with homeostasis, what we mean is that the body wants to maintain ambient conditions such that even if there are dangers or changes that are incumbent on the body from outside, they are still kept, you know, or our body is shielded from those by the process of homeostasis. And he named pain actually as a mechanism for homeostasis, but for him it was an emotion, because for him also hunger and thirst was an emotion. And in his phenomenal essay, The Expression of Emotion in Man and Animals in 1872, he went so far to postulate that there is no fundamental difference between man and animals in their ability to feel pleasure and pain, happiness and misery. So for him, pain definitely belonged also to the emotional repertoire that we have and animals also have. Now, all of this research, of course, has shaped what we think about pain. So the International Association for the Study of Pain is a major organization, right? I mean, hundreds of countries are involved in there. And it came up with an official definition in 1975. And the ISP recognized that pain is an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with either actual potential, actual tissue damage. So you, when if you have really kind of, you know, exposed yourself to an actually harmful stimulus or even a potentially harmful stimulus, and described in terms of such damage. Now, what does that mean? It sounds pretty inane, but actually what it does is it takes the body as well as the mind into account. It says you need your mind as well for pain is involved, and it makes a dichotomy between what we call as nociception, that's the sensory aspect of pain. And I should tell you, this is what we study mostly in in our model systems in animals. We are mostly targeting the sensory aspect. That's where research is farthest. And pain necessarily involves also the emotional component. And this necessarily already leads to a corollary that your pain may be different from my pain. Because in the end, it all comes down to what we perceive, how we perceive pain. And we know this, right? I mean, some of you or some of us may feel pain in response to something that others might would just laugh about, right? And would say this is absolutely not painful. And it also considers pain independently of triggers or their duration. This is very, very important. Because now let's take the case of, a patient who lost his arm, with a horrible tractor or a machine that he was using in the fields. And of course, he had a lot of pain immediately after that because of the injury and got treated for it and then was supposed to have recovered within a year, right? He has this stump. Suddenly, this man starts to complain about pain in an arm that does not exist anymore. And no health insurance took something like that to be, relevant. They would say, no, this is all just fabrication. This person does not want to work. Or this person has some psychological problems. But now we know, no, this is called as phantom pain. And indeed, this is a phenomenon which has an organic basis. And therefore, the definition of pain also takes into account that the duration of that pain trigger may be gone. There may be no pain trigger. This is what happens also with fibromyalgia patients. Externally, you do not see any pathology. Yet these people are in excruciating pain, and now it is recognized that this is indeed pain. So if you were to now go from the 16th century view of pain to the modern 21st century view of pain, we take into account not only these sensory pathways that I'll come to in a second and the fact that they sensitized, but we also take into account that there are lots of factors that modulate and form your ultimate pain experience. So pain is highly regulated by prior experience. You may toughen up against pain based upon your prior experience, but you may get so scared that you may actually become very hypersensitive, and suddenly every little thing becomes painful. If you pay attention to pain, pain will become bigger, and that's what the doctor does. He always or she always tries to distract you, right? Distract our kids also when they go for some examination. Your anxiety, your depression may regulate your pain, and there are lots and lots of changes that occur in our brain as well as nervous, other parts of the nervous system that are neurochemical as well as structural. So what we now recognize is that there's a huge complexity in somatosensory pathways that mediate pain. This starts with so-called nerve endings in the periphery, and we know that anatomically as well as neurochemically, they're very different. One of the biggest discoveries of the last 5 or 10 years has been finding molecules that are specifically expressed in these different types of sensory afferents, so to speak, that give a molecular identity to these afferents. And so we are now, with the help of genetics, we can now start to ask, what does a C fiber do? Is it the main, participant in chronic pain, or is it a so-called silent C fiber, which is usually very quiet, but may get activated a long time after injury? What we know is that there is tremendous specificity here in the periphery, and this specificity is also seen in terms of which modalities of pain are carried by these different afferent fibers. They seem to be, some are multimodal, but some are very specific. And as I just said, this ability to be able to sense these different modalities particularly is given by molecular transducers that sit in these sensory nerve endings, and they are the ones that take a physical or chemical stimuli, such as, you know, stimulus such as heat, right? How does heat cause pain? Somehow this physical nature of heat, the energy which is present in heat, has to get transported into an electrical signal here. And this is done by these ion channels, some of which are listed here. And I'll revisit them in a second. But let's move on. What happens now further along the pain pathway? So as I just mentioned, there is specificity here. So in a way, Descartes was right, and the specificity theory proponents are right in the periphery. But that's where it stops. As soon as these afferents enter the spinal cord, strangely enough, you lose all specificity. You'd think that these specific fibers, the one that mediates cold sensation, should only talk to certain neurons, and then those neurons should only talk to certain neurons in the brain. That's not true. So heat-sensitive and cold-sensitive fibers can suddenly converge upon the same neuron. So in the beginning, it does not make any sense, right? So a specificity code is converted here into a population code, which is very, very complex. And we know this also from other sensations. For example, if you've been following up the field of olfaction, our ability to be able to sense just about any odorant in the, you know, in the environment, and there might be many new odorants that are getting created, is not given by a finite set of neurons that say, I can smell, you know, vanilla versus jasmine, because then it would be a finite number, but it's given by a combinatorial code, so that if you have from a different planet now a new odorant coming, we have the ability to be able to sense it. And that's exactly how it is with pain. It's a combinatorial code which has not been cracked so far. Now the story gets even more complex as we go further along the brain. I'll just skip this. Now we are at the brain. Now here what we see is that just dozens of brain areas get activated when we perceive pain. This kind of work has mostly been done in human subjects with the help of imaging techniques such as fMRI. And, you know, scientists were really hoping that there'd be one area, just one area, which would be specific for pain. Because when with vision, we have V1 cortex, right? With olfaction, we have the olfactory bulb. With auditory stimuli, we have the auditory cortex. So why don't we have one P1 for pain, right? Turns out it doesn't exist. What we have is activation of just dozens of areas, and this led to the theory that pain is actually a kind of a percept that is generated when signals move along a matrix, and people started talking about a pain matrix. This was okay in the beginning, but then it got really weird at some point because insurance companies started to then take this pain matrix as a way of diagnosing whether a patient was lying or telling the truth, you know, whether they were feeling pain. And it started to lead to all kinds of bizarre, comparisons about whether, do you feel, you know, when you see your child in pain, is that the same as your own pain? Things like that. So at some point, luckily, there was more serious work done in a wide variety of patients by the group of Tor Vaisher, a really excellent scientist. And with the help of multivariate analysis, what he derived was a neurological signature for pain. So this includes many anatomical areas, but importantly also a kind of processing. And it's a rather complex signature. It's not very easy for me to represent it either. But it's kind of helping us now to answer questions such as, are pleasure and pain the diametrical opposites of the activation of the same pathway? So you could imagine that if there is a set of brain regions that now, you know, are the neurological signature for pain, it could mean that when the signature is very active, we feel pain, and if it's highly, you know, suppressed, we feel pleasure, right? This is one question that people are asking, because I don't know if you've ever had this percept, you know, if you've had like a migraine-like headache or a very strong headache, what happens when that headache goes away? you feel much better. You feel, in fact, better than you felt before the headache came on, right? So the end of pain is usually associated with a huge amount of pleasure. And so there are lots of new questions that are coming along this way. But I wanted to talk about chronic pain and why we feel chronic pain when the original pain, causing trigger is gone already. And why is it important to study? It's important because pain changes everything. If you've had chronic pain, there's nothing left of you. People, you know, who suffer from chronic pain think that they are now, you know, they've lost their life, they've lost themselves. And that's why it's important, even if there is no pathology, particularly then, to help figure out what is really happening. Now, chronic pain has found its expression in art. And one of the most famous artists who suffered from chronic pain, actually, nearly every writer or every artist at some point or the other was, you know, suffering from pain in the context of some disorders they had. And many of them say that it really changed the way how they write or how they paint or express themselves. But Frida Kahlo is the most famous example. She had an accident at some point, and because of that, she had tremendous injuries which healed, but later on the pain came back. And now it's being debated whether she had fibromyalgia, this syndrome where you feel intense pain all over your body and a feeling of fatigue and tiredness, but you don't see any neurochemical change in the body. You don't see anything in the fMRI or any other imaging that you do. Yet it is a disorder, it's not just something, which is a psychiatric disorder, but it has an organic basis. And this is how Kahlo would represent her pain. Virginia Woolf, on the other hand, thought that pain cannot be described at all. So she said, "Let a sufferer try to describe the pain in his head to a doctor, and language at once runs dry." So she thought there's no way you can, describe pain. That may be true for her and some of the other people. But on the other hand, we also know that, for example, headache can be described by more than 100 words. There are more than 100 words alone that you can use to describe different types of headaches. And patients also describe different types of chronic pain differently. So if you were to take a patient who has neuropathic pain caused by some nerve injury, he or she will say they feel as though pins are being, poked into their body, or they feel like that part of the body is burning. Very often they describe pain as electrifying, as though you get an electric shock. In fact, this is what most trigeminal neuralgia patients say. Every time they eat or they smile and, there's some mimic in their face, it's like an electric signal in their trigeminal nerve, extremely painful. No wonder it is also called as the suicide disorder. So after depression, the second most frequent causes of suicide given by trigeminal neuralgia. On the other hand, if you have pain, and this you might have seen in your parents or the elderly, which is caused by certain inflammatory disorders such as musculoskeletal pain, that is not electrifying or burning pain. Mostly you feel sensitive, it feels like something's pulling, or you feel very stiff and uncomfortable. So it means that, pain has you can have different types of languages to define different types of pain. Now, what is the problem actually with pain therapy? Why is it so challenging? Well, first of all, what I was talking about so far was all acute pain, right? I was talking about how it can come around in this pathway. Now, you would think if we were to understand acute pain, we should be able to understand chronic pain. It turns out that's not true, because chronic pain is not the same, line has shifted here. Chronic pain is not the same as long-lasting acute pain. So it's not as if, if acute pain were just to get a little bit longer, that it is what we call as chronic pain. It's an entirely different disorder by itself. And secondly, we do not know the molecular determinants, the cellular function, and also the networks that mediate this type of pain. So one hypothesis that has been placed and, which is very widely accepted throughout the world, is that our nociceptive pathway, that is the pathway that mediates the sensory component of pain, can undergo tremendous plasticity. And I'm sure you're aware of the word plasticity, but for those who are not, generally it means the ability to learn from experience. It can be something very good. I mean, this is the basis of learning. Right? We learn because of plasticity of our synapses, plasticity of our nervous system. But that also can be maladaptive plasticity, which can also then lead to pain. So how could you imagine that? Well, it takes place at many different levels. So you can imagine it at the molecular level. For example, one of these channels that I was talking about could now get phosphorylated, or it might have some other post-translational modification which makes it very, very, you know, sensitive, or it can change its properties. And this can then lead to change at the next level where the neurons talk to each other. That would be the synaptic level. And you know that our synapses, they can go to extremes. You can have synapses that are absolutely silent, or you can have synapses that are maximally potentiated. To every little change, they react. This can then lead to changes at the level of cells. So what we see here is in blue, for example, this could be the regular, let's say normal response of a cell in the pain pathway to a pain stimulus, such as, you know, hitting yourself or getting your finger caught in the door. But if your system is sensitized because of some previous experience, suddenly not only would these neurons fire much, much more, but they might continue to fire even after your stimulus is over. And finally, changes at the cellular level can also lead to network plasticity. One such example is given, in this slide here. So for example, if you were to do calcium imaging and look at, you know, responses in the spinal cord, basically you can see which cells get activated. If you were to now stimulate, one half of your body, let's say your leg, you would get a finite response. If you do the same thing when that leg is inflamed, when you've had inflammation in that leg, you will not only get responses on this half, but you'll also get responses on the other half, which is very strange, right? Because there are usually very strong somatotropic boundaries. And that means that this spread of excitation can overcome somatotropic boundaries. That means that networks have to get reorganized, and this is exactly what happens. Now the way we paint it is as though, you know, every time you have an injury or inflammation, you'd feel chronic pain. That's not really true, right? Many of us have at some point or the other had injury, and luckily we never develop chronic pain. So even though there are several triggers that can lead to intense activation of pain pathways and thereby trigger plasticity, luckily, we have one saving grace, and that is our endogenous inhibition. That is what is kind of keeping the scales in order and preventing pathological pain. And so if you were to now get down to the neurobiology, what you see on the pronociceptive side are, you know, typical excitatory pathways and molecules such as glutamate, excitatory neuropeptides, modulators that potentiate excitation. On the inhibitory side, we have our endogenous opioids, right? We have a very strong endogenous endorphin or opioidergic system. We have GABA, glycine, cannabinoids, and several others as inhibitory neurotransmitters. And as mechanisms for this kind of plasticity, you can now come down to your molecular processes that you also study here. Receptor and signaling mechanisms, neurotransmitter release can be changed. You can have protein-protein interactions that change the, you know, way these molecular pathways work. And there's tremendous regulation at the transcriptional level, right? This leads to the long-lasting nature of pain. Now, I'm a neurobiologist, so I like to focus on these kind of things. But now I also am aware of, you know, beautiful work from psychologists and other disciplines in pain, which show that the emotional background and psyche has a tremendous impact on all of that. And I think this is something we always have to keep in mind. And that, of course, also has an organic basis. Now, I'd like to just show you some examples of plasticity at each of these three different stations before I finish. So at the peripheral level, now if you were to just go back to the peripheral level, remember we talked about some ion channels that are expressed in these peripheral nerve endings. And many of these channels belong to the so-called TRIP family. That stands for transient receptor potential. So these ion channels are permeable to ions such as sodium and calcium. And there is a huge family, there's a big family of them, TRIP-V, TRIP-A, TRIP-C, TRIP-M8 family. And what's interesting is that some of these ion channels seem to encode for painful heat, whereas some of the other ion channels seem to encode for painful cold. And they also encode for lots and lots of other algogens, meaning substances that cause pain. What better substance is known that causes intense pain but chili, right? Capsaicin. This is an active ingredient of chili, extremely painful. Turns out that activates TRIPV1. There's also in garlic, we have certain ingredients, AITC, that's an ingredient in garlic. Then also acid is extremely painful, of course, right? You know, from acid bombs and whatnot. Turns out protons, that is acid, also activate this ion channel and so on and so forth. But of course, this is just meant to signify external stimuli. We have lots and lots of allergens that sit in our body. For example, our skin is full of prostanoids. That's what happens when you have inflammation. You have increase in prostanoid synthesis, and these then can also activate these TRP channels. In contrast, camphor, which is also pretty pungent, activates TRPV3. And now here comes the interesting part. We have also substances on the other end of scale. What do? If you're feeling hot, you drink something cold, right? And cold seems to reduce the heat-induced pain or chili-induced pain. Or you might eat some menthol. Menthol activates TRPM8, and somehow that seems to counter TRPV1-induced pain. And then we have all kinds of other ingredients that activate yet another TRP channel, very important TRP channel called TRPA1. This is activated by environmental toxins, by allergens, cinnamon, garlic, horseradish, right? That's also, if you eat in large quantities, also painful. And this is given by TRPA1. So here you have now for the first time, either something, you know, which is heat or, you know, a chemical, a physical stimulus or a chemical stimulus finally getting converted into an electrical stimulus. So how does that happen? That happens at the nerve endings where these TRP channels are expressed. These TRP channels directly get regulated by heat, cold, protons, toxins, lipids, etc. And they create a minuscule receptor potential. This is a very small change in the membrane potential, which is not sufficient to activate the entire neuron. Absolutely not. It's a very, very small change. But what we have next or in close vicinity of these TRP channels are the classical sodium channels. So this small change in potential is enough to activate a variety of sodium channels. And amongst these, we also have sodium channels that are highly specific for pain-sensing neurons, luckily, right? Because that could be the key to just stopping pain without having side effects on all possible neurons. And this is how the signal then gets further sent along the nerve to the spinal cord. Now, therefore, you can imagine, since this is the first, you know, avenue where the environment meets the nervous system to trigger pain, this molecule or these molecules are highly susceptible to changes, to plasticity. And I'm sure you have also experienced this yourself. For example, when you got your hand burned with a grill in the summer. What happened there? When your hand got burned, you had inflammatory molecules that were released, and these inflammatory molecules go on and sensitize your TRP channel. So normally your TRP channel, TRPV1, would only get activated at 42 degrees, and that's why you can shower at 37 or 40 degrees and not feel any pain. But what happened once you had this, this inflammation on your skin? You put your hand under 37 or 40 degrees, suddenly it's painful. Reason being, because TRPV1 gets phosphorylated, and now instead of getting activated at 42 degrees, it gets activated at 37 degrees. So already at body temperature, it's firing away and telling your body, I'm in pain, right? So this is how you can imagine chronic pain can be caused. Now, unfortunately, chronic pain is not blocked by blockers of, you know, prostaglandin synthesis. So we can't block chronic pain with aspirin. This works on acute pain, but not chronic pain. And the reason being that we have other sensitizers that come into play. So my lab has been working on identifying molecules that are released, for example, by tumor cells or by immune cells in the context of cancer-induced pain or immune-induced pain, so chronic inflammatory disorders. And I will not show you primary data, that will take too long, but suffice it to say that we found some really surprising things. So for example, I'm sure you're aware of the Wnt family of developmental molecules. Wnts are very important in the development because they signal via the classical beta-catenin signaling pathway to regulate several aspects of, you know, how our body is formed, how our body axis is formed, so on and so forth. Turns out, the expression of these receptors persists in adult life. These receptors are still around, and they are induced when now the ligands start to get released by tumor cells or by immune cells. And what we found was with using, you know, cell-specific knockouts and things like that, that this pathway, which is developmentally very active, is actually not at all involved in this, you know, chronic pain, in inflammation and cancer, but rather there is a new component. The RAC-JNK pathway gets activated, and JNK, the, you know, the kinase JNK, phosphorylates TRPV1 and leads to increased expression of TRPV1 at the cell surface. So you get a better membrane targeting of TRPV1, and that's why now you start to feel more pain via these signals. This work was done by Manuela Simonetti. I wanted to mention not only the people, of course, but also the origin, because I know EMBL is very international, and that's also one of the major, you know, strengths of my lab, something that I like very, very much. Let me take another example in terms of cancer pain. People who have cancer have excruciating pain. Not all cancers are painful, but very often it's the metastases in the bone particularly, which are extremely painful, and that just kills the quality of their life, particularly in the last stages of their life, right? So they have to be sedated nearly all the time, and do not have any time to spend with their loved ones before death. So we started asking, you know, what could be mediators that are released by cancer cells? So we know that cancers release vascular endothelial growth factors, and these are important for tumor angiogenesis, right? You've heard of VEGF. And what is known as that is that VEGFs, or VEGFs, usually act in the blood vessels via the so-called VEGF receptor 2. And VEGF receptor 1 is rather a decoy receptor. It actually inhibits angiogenesis. Now, we were asking, we know that, you know, these receptors were expressed during development in nerves, because during development, turns out that blood vessels and nerves develop together. They go hand in hand. So we asked, could they be re-expressed in states of cancer pain? And the answer is yes. If you now look at mouse sensory neurons and also axons, you see that some of the expression, and that's seen in yellow, of VEGF receptor 1 in this case, not 2, which is in blood vessels, is actually in neurons. And importantly, if you now go and take tissues from cancer patients, and we have, you know, luckily very good collaborations here with the Heidelberg Surgery Clinic, where we take material from human pancreatic adenoductal carcinoma patients. This is the most painful cancer you can imagine, horribly painful terminal form of cancer. You see that the expression of this receptor is increased in patients with severe pain as compared to patients who only have mild pain. And now then you can go back in the lab, you can culture sensory neurons, you can throw this ligand on them and say, you know, what happens? Indeed, what you see is that these neurons become hypersensitive. They start firing at a higher frequency. And then you can make either knockouts that are specific for these neurons, or you can knock them down. And then you can study cancer pain. So basically, we have models in which we can simulate bone metastatic growth. And in mice, therefore, you keep getting an increased response to a normally non-painful stimulus. All we are doing here is we are coming with a very minute filament, which is exerting 0.007 grams of pressure. A normal mouse would not even look down, would not realize. But what does a mouse with tumors do? It pulls the paw back. It finds it excruciatingly painful. And you see that this response increases as the tumor progresses. And if you do that now in mice which lack the receptor specifically in these sensory neurons, not in blood vessels, then you can actually block a large part of this pain. So this was just an example. Of course, it's also important to translate some of these disorders, these findings. So we work together with Genentech, which is a major biotechnology company in the Bay Area. And Genentech has developed new antibodies against receptors for VEGFR1 and R2. And they shared these antibodies with us. So what we saw was that when we gave these mice anti-VEGFR2, we did not have a big change in the pain that they were feeling. But with anti-VEGFR1, we had quite a decrease in cancer pain, and it also changed the remodeling of peripheral nerves. This work was done by Dipita Selvaraj and Vijayan Gangadharan from my lab. And so what we can now summarize is that during tumor angiogenesis, we have a pathway which is coming, or where VEGFR2 is the key player. And in parallel, in the nerves, which are not very far away from the blood vessels, we have VEGFR1 expression. And mechanistically, we found this also leads to a phosphorylation of TRPV1. Now, one of the last things I wanted to show for the periphery here was that, you know, also T cells, immune cells, also can release mediators. And we recently discovered a mediator, which is a neutrophil elastase, so far not known to play any role in the nervous system. And we saw that it can also sensitize these neurons. So basically, T cells directly invade the sensory ganglia in the vicinity of these sensory neurons and release this elastase, which can then cause pain. It can cause abnormal activity of these peripheral nerves. And this work was done by Lucas Vicuña from Chile. And now, of course, it's important for us to take this further to the clinics, right? Because it turns out there are inhibitors of leukocyte elastase that are in use or are in development for the treatment of airway inflammation. So we do have now one handle that we could, you know, continue with in the clinic. But before we do that, of course, it would be important, since all of this work was based on mouse, to be able to verify this in humans. And one strategy that we are now currently starting to use is to generate human nociceptors and mechanoceptors from iPSC cells or from human embryonic stem cells. And then we can culture these, and then we can, for example, throw our leukocyte elastase on them and ask, do they change? You know, could this be also important in the human context? So these are the kind of things that we're doing right now. Now, in terms of the spinal cord, and I have to check time. I should hurry up. In the spinal cord, this is where the peripheral nervous system talks for the first time with the central nervous system. And here we know that we have several modulators and mediators, particularly glutamate is important for synapses. But the major discovery of this last decade has been that actually other cells, non-neuronal cells, such as microglia and astrocytes, also play a very important role. And I'm sure you've been seeing all this work published, being published in very high-ranking journals. But now coming back to neurons, we know that synapses can change, right? We can have both presynaptic as well as postsynaptic changes that lead to long-term potentiation of synapses. And therefore, a synapse can go from silent state to a fully potentiated stage based upon these changes. Now, what we found was that at this first synapse, there is an entire cascade which involves lots of mediators that leads to long-term potentiation of these synapses, and that may encode for pain memory. So this is the classical, you know, Teufelskreis, as you say in English, in German, or vicious circle, where we have increased neurotransmitter release. This then activates pathways that leads to further neurotransmitter release. So this synapse just keeps going in circles and activating itself. This work was done by Dr. San Luo from China. And with all of these aspects, you could still say, but wait a minute, all these are transient changes. I mean, you know, something gets phosphorylated, that's a matter of minutes to hours. Synapse gets potentiated, really, for how long? So how can this, you know, lead to chronic pain? Now, that's true. For chronic pain to occur, you need to have some reprogramming at the nuclear level. You have to have changes in, you know, at the genetic level. And this is what happens. So what we found, and others have also found this, is that we have, you know, calcium waves that travel from the synapse directly to the cell nucleus. And these waves can then activate genetic programs by activating transcription factors. And we found some really interesting molecules via this genetic program, again, the work of Manuela. Finally, I was talking about functional changes. But it's not as if, you know, it's just the function of neurons that changes. It's also the structure of neurons that changes. So, for example, what we found was that when we now look at models of chronic pain, we see that the number of spines increases. We suddenly start having more and more synaptic contacts because of actin remodeling. And Jenning Lu in my lab discovered some of the molecular mechanisms which involve a ROGEF, which leads to actin rearrangement and thereby leads to these spine changes. And the question is, can you modulate these by pharmacological agents? And this work was done by Christian Nu in the lab, who used cannabinoids as a therapeutic strategy. You know, cannabinoids have recently now been legalized for treatment of pain, right, in Germany just last month. And he found out that if you were to use cannabinoids, you can actually block this kind of structural remodeling of synapses. And finally, now, just to show you the last part with the brain, this is very, very complex. And that's why we are very lucky that we have a so-called collaborative research center, which involves 34 different groups in Heidelberg now. This has been recently funded by the German Research Foundation, and we are following up projects where we are trying to functionally map pain pathways and ask what is really specific for pain. Just to show you in two slides, one quick example, what we know is, for example, if you were to do a meta-analysis of humans who are in pain and look at their brain signals, the highest signals you see are in this area, which is called as the anterior cingulate cortex. So this has been thought to be a seat of pain. It's also thought by some to be a seat for fear. We feel fear because you activate this area. So the question was, is that really true, or is there some specificity? Because it's very controversial. Some people say only the effect, that means the hurt feeling of pain, this aversive feeling, comes from the ACC. Some say no, it also the sensory part, and some even go and say no, actually the ACC is being activated to inhibit pain. So one way of, doing or trying to delineate that is to go back in mice and ask, can we now delineate structure-function relationships? This is what Lynette did with the use of optogenetics, hitting this area in mice and then activating these. And this is the last experiment I want to show you. It's really cool. What she did was she trained mice so that they, would freely go between two different chambers. And she injected these mice either with GFP or with this optogenetic sensor, channel rhodopsin, which can lead to activation of neurons when you shine blue light, right? Now, she did the following experiment. She let these mice wander between these two chambers, and every time they went to the blue chamber, she would zap the light on. So basically, suddenly, their ACC would get activated. But of course, that didn't happen in GFP mice because that's not channel rhodopsin, so that's a control. These mice just freely walked back and forth. So what you see here is the walking behavior of the mice. Now, when she activated their rostral ACC, this is a subpart of the cingulate cortex, she saw that these mice barely spent any time there. Every time they entered and she activated the ACC, they ran out and they spent time here. In contrast, when she activated the mid-cingulate cortex with channel rhodopsin, they had no problem. So basically, what this suggests is that we have specificity of regions. We have an area which seems to code for negative effect or the aversive component of pain. And these guys here, they don't care. But if she were to activate this area, what she sees is that the sensory component of pain, this is what I was showing you earlier, where the mice suddenly withdraw very quickly. This is activated, or this is enhanced, when she activates the mid-cingulate cortex. So mind you, there is no peripheral inflammation or cancer or nerve injury in these mice. This is typically what we would see in an inflamed mouse. But this phenotype is caused simply by activating the MCC. So what this tells you is you can generate pain via the brain. You do not always need a peripheral stimulus. So this collaborative research center is asking questions, just interaction between pain, fear, stress, and depression. It's trying to understand reorganization or remodeling of the brain. We're doing experiments where we also image neurons in the brain over longitudinal studies, where we basically label these neurons by making a brain window and image them in a living mouse. And then we can induce, for example, neuropathy or inflammation or cancer. And then over weeks to months, we can ask what happens to these synapses. Do they undergo changes? And indeed, you start to see all kinds of changes. So post-injury, lots and lots of spines change in their structure. So this is all ongoing work. And it's, there are so many different avenues that you can pursue in pain. You can study ion channels. You can study structures. You can go and do research in humans and look at entire pathways or psychosocial behavior. In the end, we all, of course, have the common goal, as Galen, from Permagon said all those years ago, divinum est sedare dolorum, divine is the task to relieve pain. Unfortunately, I'm not doing this task, but we'd be very happy if some of our work would lead to that. So with this, I'd like to thank all the funding agencies, and particularly thank my research group and all the others in this field. Thank you very much for your kind and patient attention.
Thanks for your talk. I wanted to ask you, do you know if in the case of fibromyalgia, is the pain caused by inflammation or is more neuropathology or is it something else known now?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because with fibromyalgia, basically, there is lack of any kind of obvious pathologies. You don't really find anything when you analyze neurochemically. What has been, however, recently found is that indeed there is some loss of nerve fibers in the periphery. So fibromyalgia may have some, you know, common features with like diabetic neuropathy or so. And secondly, there have been also studies that have looked at the expression of microRNAs in serum of patients or in the CSF of patients. And strangely enough, there are several microRNAs that are upregulated that are usually associated also with pain in other circumstances. So that's why now there is more and more belief that there is an organic basis to fibromyalgia, but what it is not clear. So there might be a small level of neuropathy, but not really. And there's definitely no inflammation. So it's still a very big mystery, but at least these patients are getting, you know, are now getting taken very seriously.
Yeah, thanks for the interesting talk. Postsynaptic potentiation is also known to be regulated by calcium calmodulin kinases, actually. It's like CAMKs. So have you any focus on that area also?
Yeah, that's a very good point. Yes, actually, this is one of the first things that was done at that time, I mean, in the glutamatergic era. So after the glutamate channels were cloned, and I was also working on cell-specific knockouts and, you know, looking at plasticity in the spinal cord. This is old work from early 2000s or late 90s. And we found evidence for, you know, glutamate receptor plasticity. And a lot of that also has to do then with calcium-induced activation of chem kinase 2. So chem kinase 2 alpha gets activated, you get phosphorylation of, several different effector proteins there. And so basically what is known in the hippocampus of chem kinase 2 also seems to hold that spinal synapses. Yeah, so it's an interesting target, but as far as I know, it's never really been, you know, developed as a real target, right, for drug therapy. I guess it's too widely expressed. That's the problem.
Hi. So you said that cannabinoids are being used for treatment of to revert aspects of long-term potentiation. Mm-hmm. Is that right? So how does that work? So you mentioned that it's modulation of the cytoskeleton and thereby reduction of the contacts in the spinal cord. But as far as I know, the cannabinoid use is just temporarily relief for such patients. So how does that work with the long-term potentiation?
Yeah, it's a very good question. Actually, long-term potentiation, we don't know how long it really lasts. Unfortunately, because, you know, we can only hold these synapses in our electrophysiology experiments for a few hours. So there's nobody has figured out how long LTP really lasts in vivo. And what we found was that cannabinoids, if you give them continuously, so basically we gave inflamed animals continuously over a few days, and usually we would have seen increase in the number of synapses. This did not occur when we gave them cannabinoids, and this had a very clear molecular pathway. I did not talk about all of that. What we see is that in proteomic studies, we see that CB1, the cannabinoid receptor, actually interacts with the wave complex, wave 1 complex, and that is a master regulator of actin cytoskeleton. And we see that is the way, basically, how cannabinoids can quickly dismantle synapses. So this could also be the mechanism how cannabinoids are changing cognitive processes in the brain, right? Because cannabinoids are useful in a way for extinguishing memories. And that's why, you know, also in other syndromes, not just chronic pain, there is a lot of talk of trying out cannabinoids because they can drive extinction. And so maybe it's the same complex that comes into play, but this is what we found in the spinal cord.
Hello. So you showed that pain and fear is aroused in the same brain area. So does that mean that there is something like chronic fear as well, which I guess is true?
Yeah.
And can that be treated in some cases with pain relief substances?
Yeah, that's a very good point. Exactly. I mean, the boundaries between fear and pain are very, very diffuse. chronic pain makes people fearsome, but fear makes people very predisposed to chronic pain. In fact, there have been studies which showed that, you know, if you were to take a person who has, you know, an acute back injury or, you know, little, some problem somewhere, right, usually people would recover, but some don't. And some then have chronic back pain, which gets worse and worse and worse. And if you were to now kind of divide them into cohort, you can see that people who had shown fearsome behavior, fearful behavior, not fearsome, fearful behavior in the beginning, who were predisposed to fear, are exactly the ones who tend to chronify pain. So they tend to catastrophize everything, they tend to chronify pain. Now the basis of that, right, this has all been shown in, you know, psychological analyses and imaging studies also, but how that comes together is mechanistically it's not known. So what we're doing is, I mean, I talked about the cingulate cortex, it's a very deep-seated region, but we are also looking at the prefrontal cortex, which is another part, very close by but further up, so it's more easy to image and do electrophysiology in. And what we see is, you know, there are all these new tagging approaches, genetic tags that you can bring on yours, you can trace their lineage. So we are trying to ask, when a mouse is, you know, encountering fear, do you get the same neurons activated as when the mouse is encountering pain? So is it one and the same type of neurons that mediates both, or is there some specificity? And I can't tell you the answer yet. We are working on this. It seems like there is some specificity and some common neurons, but there are some neurons which are really specific only for fear. And we are again using optogenetics to switch them off and ask, will the pain response change? We think that it does not. So we think that indeed fear and pain are separate but very close. So in the same, they are in the same brain regions, but it could be that there is some selectivity at the single neuronal level. But you know, in the end, the way the cortex is organized, there is a very rapid spread of excitation. So it could be that that's why the scenario could be, this is our hypothesis, that these are two distinct sets of neurons that mediate pain and fear under normal circumstances. But if you were to go into a pathological chronic pain circumstance where, you know, our psyche changes totally, it could be that there is a lot of overlap. This is the current hypothesis in the field.
Isn't fear perception normally associated with the amygdala?
Yes.
That's not the same brain region as you referring to for
right, yes, yes. So I was referring to the anterior cingulate cortex, which is also important in pain. So with fear, it's like this. We have two, you know, at least in the animal studies where it's kind of broken down and simplified, we have at least two different types of fear. We have contextual fear, and there actually it's largely independent of the amygdala. Mm. There you have hippocampal circuits together with the cingulate cortex that come together and lead to contextual fear. And then you also have, you know, fear associated with some conditioning. So, for example, if you use an auditory stimulus to kind of condition fear, where you kind of associate that stimulus, you know, the tone with something that causes pain. Actually, pain is used as the conditioning stimulus there. And that causes long-term fear. That circuit involves the amygdala. And there are also studies that show that in, you know, certain types of chronic pain patients, you get quite a lot of activation of the amygdala. So what we need to now do is to figure out, you know, is this something specific for pain, or is it because simply these humans are just, you know, feeling, you know, a lot of fear because of their pain, and is it because of that that you get amygdala activation?
Once I read in a Temple Grandin book that there is a difference between, I don't know, the development of some regions in the cortex that drives us to feel more hurt as well as pain. And so this feeling is greater than in animals, for example. I don't know if it is right or not.
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, yeah, it's a big debate, right? I mean, the question is, do animals have consciousness and therefore do they have pain? I mean, they, of course, if you have a cat or a dog at home, you know that they feel pain, right? But then often the people who argue against consciousness in animals argue that that's simply nociception, because even a person in coma can respond to a painful stimulus. That does not mean that they feel pain. It's just your protective, you know, sensory component which wants to kind of save yourself. But, I mean, I have cats at home and they are like my children and I know they feel pain and I know they feel hurt and they feel... So I fully agree with Darwin that, you know, these animals also have all of these emotions that we also have. So I don't know, you know, about studies that have now really systematically looked at animals versus humans with respect to brain regions that could be specific, more specific for humans. I mean, we work with mice and rats and these are also... They also have the same regions as humans, actually. So I know that, you know, our neocortex may be a bit more developed, it's a bit more folded, but it's not really very different from that of a mouse. And we get also activation of the same areas in mice as, you know, human patients show. There are areas such in the prefrontal cortex, which are very interesting because they get activated not only when you are in pain, but also when you see somebody else in pain. And strangely enough, in people, in you know, psychopaths, who actually enjoy pain, who enjoy inflicting pain, who enjoy watching gruesome images of people in pain, these areas are not activated. So that's why there is a lot of reason. I agree with you. There are certain areas that we have in the brain, in the frontal cortex, that may be more specific for this kind of, you know, feeling of hurt. This emotion could come from those areas.
So if there are no more questions, then I think we should thank Rohini for a very enlightening and interesting talk.
Thank you very much.